Welcome to the Five Rivers Podcast. For more information, head to fiveriverschurch.com. We now join our services already in progress.
Good morning. Welcome to Five Rivers. So great to see everybody. Those of you at home, thank you for joining us. Let's all stand up together. We're just going to praise his name this morning. Amen. Jehovah Nisi, fight your battles. 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 Jehovah Jireh. Jehovah Jireh, meet your need. Jehovah Rapha.
Jehovah Rapha, heal your body.
Jehovah Shalom.
Jehovah Shalom, be your peace.
Jehovah Nisi,
Jehovah Nisi, fight your battles.
Jehovah Jireh, meet your need.
Jehovah Rapha, heal your body.
Jehovah Shalom, be your peace. Call his name.
Call the
Nisi.
Jehovah Nisi, fight your battles. Jehovah Jireh, meet your need. Jehovah Rapha, heal your body. Jehovah Shalom, be your peace. Jehovah Nisi, fight your battles. Jehovah Jireh, meet your need.
Jehovah Rapha.
Jehovah Rapha, heal your body. Jehovah Shalom, be your peace.
Call his name.
Call the name. Call the name. Call the name. Jehovah. All our praise. All our praise. All our praise belongs to him.
Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord.
Bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul. Worship his holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul. I'll worship your holy name. The sun comes up, it's a new day dawning. It's time to sing your song again. Whatever may pass and whatever lies before me, let me be singing when the evening comes. Bless the worship his holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul, I'll worship your holy name. You're rich in love and you're slow to anger. Your name is great and your heart is kind. For all your goodness I will keep on singing. 10,000 reasons for my heart to find. Bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul. Worship his holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul, I'll worship your holy name. And on that day when my strength is failing, the end draws near and my time has come, still my soul will sing your praise unending. 10,000 years and then forevermore. Bless the Lord, oh my soul. Worship his holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul, I'll worship your holy name. Bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul, worship his holy. Your holy name, oh, I'll worship your holy name. Yes, I'll worship your holy name.
Holy, 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 holy.
cry, holy, holy, holy. Holy, holy, holy. Holy, holy, holy. I want to see you. Yes, we do. Oh, we cry, holy, holy, holy. Holy, holy, holy. Holy, holy, holy. I want to see you. And open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart. I want to see you. I want to see you. Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart. I want to see you. I want to see you. To see you.
Tremble, Jesus, Jesus. Call these bones to live. Call these lungs to sing once again. I will praise all breathing. Call these bones to live. Call these lungs to sing once again. I will praise, oh Jesus, Jesus. You make the darkness tremble, Jesus, Jesus. You silence fear, oh Jesus, Jesus. You make the darkness tremble, Jesus, Jesus.
Call and sing his name.
Oh, Jesus, Jesus. You make the darkness tremble, Jesus, Jesus. You silence fear. Oh, Jesus, Jesus. You make the darkness tremble, Jesus, Jesus.
Your name is a light that the shadows can't deny. Your name cannot be overcome. Your name is a light forever lifted high. Your name cannot be overcome. Oh, your name is a light that the shadows can't deny. Your name cannot be overcome. Your name is a light forever lifted high. Your name cannot be overcome.
Oh, Jesus, Jesus.
You make the darkness tremble.
Oh, Jesus, Jesus.
Silence fear.
Oh, Jesus, Jesus.
You make the darkness tremble. Jesus, Jesus.
Your name is a light that the shadows can't deny. Your name cannot be overcome. Your name is a light forever lifted high. Your name cannot be overcome. Oh yes, your is a light that the shadows can't deny. Your name cannot be overcome. Oh, your name is a light forever lifted high. Your name cannot be overcome. Shadows can't deny. Your name cannot be overcome. Your name, your name is a light forever lifted high. Your name cannot be overcome. Sing his name,
oh Jesus, Jesus. You make the darkness tremble, Jesus, Jesus. You silence fear, Jesus, Jesus. You make the darkness tremble, Jesus, Jesus.
Oh,
oh Jesus, Jesus. Oh Jesus.
Silence fear, oh Jesus, Jesus. You make the darkness tremble, Jesus, Jesus.
just your name, the name of Jesus, hallelujah. The name of Jesus eliminates all fear, all anxiety. Jesus, hallelujah. Your name is a light that the shadows can't deny. Your name cannot be overcome. Your name is alive, forever lifted high. Your name cannot be overcome. Your name is a light that the shadows can't deny. Your name cannot be overcome. Your name is a light forever lifted high. Your name cannot be overcome. One more time. Your name is a light that the shadows can't deny. Your name cannot be overcome. Your name is alive, forever lifted high. Your name cannot be overcome. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. That name cannot be overcome. Amen. Hallelujah. We praise you, Lord. We lift you up. We worship you, Father. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. He is good. Amen. Amen. Just that name. Just that name. Well, it's great to see everybody this morning. Thank you for coming out to Five Rivers. Let's greet each other this morning. Shake a hand, hug a neck. Send a text to somebody. Those of you at home, send a text to somebody here, anywhere as they're watching. As we move to our morning announcements, tithes, and offering.
Good morning, Five Rivers family. Well, by now the church will be back to a more normal looking state after a great week of VBS. We want to thank anybody who helped out in any way. We could not have done it without you. This is Fair Week in Cecil County. The sign-up sheets for time slots at the Five Rivers booth are still available at the hospitality desk. If you have any questions about this, you can talk to Ellen Tomlinson. Remember that the adult Bible study and children's classes are taking Wednesdays off in July, and they will resume August 7th. Crew Youth is still meeting on the dates indicated. And you can still sign up at the hospitality desk for the Grief Share support group at Pleasant View Baptist Church in Perryville that will meet August through October. If you have questions about this, you can speak to Paul Benicki. And ladies, next Sunday is the annual Women's Ministry Pool Party at the home of Amy Stevenson right after church. There is more information and a sign-up sheet at the hospitality desk. And today is Mission Sunday, so remember to give your missions offerings and check out some of the newsletters and the Worldview magazines available in the lobby. Have a blessed week, family. And here is a video about training leaders in Samoa, where Five Rivers supports AG missionaries.
Samoa is a volcanic island. You see lots of sandy beaches, tropical trees. There's no winter in Samoa. It's tropical weather all year long. It's very warm. Samoans are very happy people. People are very friendly. You know, Samoan people are known for their hospitality. You know, it's a very slow-paced kind of life in Samoa compared to other big countries of the world. Samoa as a whole, I would like to see God raising up leadership. We pray that people will get to have a revival where they will be really sensing the presence of the Lord. We are seeing churches being planted. More souls have been saved. People are hungry for the Lord.
Hey, hey, good morning, everyone. I want to thank you for being here today and also give a thanks to all of those who are tuning in to our live stream. I want to give an additional thank you this morning to all of our amazing VBS volunteers. I know it was very much a labor of love, but when we all get to heaven and we see the results, you're going to know that all of your effort is very much worth it. I look forward to being back next week with my family, and we will give further expressions of gratitude to our VBS volunteers. Well, this morning our guest speaker needs no introduction. She is well loved by everyone, and her ministry here is always well received. So would you welcome to the platform to minister God's word to us this morning, Reverend Maria Donnelly.
Hope everyone. Good morning, all of you. It's great to be in the house of the Lord today, is it not? Praise God. Well, my name, for those of you who don't know me, if you're new here or online, my name is Maria Donnelly. My husband, Tom, and I are missionary chaplains under U.S. Missions with Assembly of God U.S. Missions. We're missionary chaplains here in Elkton, Maryland. Amen. Praise God. We are U.S. missions. Praise the Lord. Amen. Praise the Lord. Because, you know, we need missions. We need to bring the gospel to our community. And we bring the gospel to those who are forgotten in the community, to people that the church just cannot reach. And the way we see it in our community are three groups of people. They're the elderly in institutional care or assisted living. Did you know that 60% of those living in institutional care never get a visitor? Never. Ever. You know, they become old and frail, or for whatever reason, their family has to put them in institutional care because they can't care for them. And the church isn't there anymore. There's no more visits, and there's a lot of times their family can't even visit them. But we go out and visit them. And we have a team here from this wonderful, beautiful local church that we bring our team, we bring them Sunday services and prayer and music and love. And we do that and so that they are no longer forgotten, and it's changed the place. So our vision as U.S. missionaries is to equip churches all over the country to do this, medium and small churches and even large churches if they're not doing that already. The next group of forgotten people that we minister to are students in the local elementary school, under-resourced kids, Title I kids. We bring a homework program to them. We teach them reading, writing, and math, and we hope to be able to share the gospel of Jesus with their families and the teachers and the staff. And we have a wonderful team right here in this local church that does that. And we just finished our first semester. It was wonderful. I met with them this week over at the school, and they can't wait for us to come back, and it's going to be better than ever. And so we do that. We bring them homework help. You see, we can't tell them about Jesus if we're not meeting needs. We just can't walk in and say, would you receive Jesus into your heart? We can, and I do that, but a lot of times we have to meet people's needs first and show them the love of God first. The other way we bring the gospel to those who are forgotten in our local community is to the local detention center, to the Cecil County Detention Center. We bring a Bible study there. I bring a Bible study to the women there. I go every week with Bible study and discipleship. And this week, every week, someone gets saved. Amen. So listen, I know we've got a lot of supporters here, a lot of partners in the ministry. And it's because of partners in the ministry that missionaries are able to go out into their community. Every week, at least, one person gets saved, or several people get saved. I had a girl this week, and then it becomes discipleship. So we disciple them, and we teach them about the love of God and how to live a Christian life, how to live a life that's good. They go into the prison. First of all, they're just like you and I. When I go in there, the first time I went, I met a woman with blonde hair and like three sons who was my age. And I, you know, in the back of my head, I'm thinking, how did you get here? But they're just like me. You would never imagine this person is in a prison for the most part. Sometimes I get some, you know, rougher folks, and you can tell that they're having a hard time, and they're there for a reason. But for the most part, the women that come to my chaplaincy, to my services, they're like us. But guess what? They've heard of Jesus, but they don't know him. They're not born again. They don't know how to read a Bible. They don't know how to pray. They don't know the Old Testament. They don't know what you know. They don't know what I know. So we bring them the gospel, and it changes their lives. And I have this amazing privilege of watching people's lives change in front of my eyes, to see someone receive Christ and change, completely change. It's amazing and wonderful. Yesterday, I'm going to call this girl Belinda, because I always like that name, Belinda. You know, like from Belinda Carlisle. Anybody remember that from the 80s? Belinda? Who was that? What was the name of that group? I can't think of it. But anyway, this girl, she was young. What's that? Anyway, this girl was young and beautiful, gorgeous, sweet as pie. She was telling me, you know, whenever I get a new group, the group that I had this week hadn't had chaplaincy in a while. Usually, I guess I kept getting the same group, and I was discipling them. Well, this group was like, you know, we want to go to chapel, too. They don't ever mix them. It's complicated. So I get a new group. So whenever I get a new group, I tell them about myself. I give them, you know, because I want to get to know them, and I want to hear a little bit about them, and I tell them about myself, and I gave them my testimony. And I told them that, I told her my story, and I told her how to get a new life in Christ. I told her that, I grew up in a broken home, and even as a teenager, I was looking for ways to satisfy my soul. Because I was broken. I grew up in a broken home. I didn't know Jesus. I was Catholic. I went to church on Christmas and Easter and a couple times in between, here and there, but I wasn't born again. And so I, you know, went astray as I was a teenager. And then I realized this is going to hurt me. This is not a healthy way to live, because I started to quench my thirst with alcohol and drugs. And I know that will just kill you. That will not help you. It will not save you. It will kill you, though. Amen. And we've got to preach that message. But people quench their thirst with these things. And then I decided, well, I'm going to do well in school. I was the first person to graduate from high school, second person to graduate from high school in my family, first person to go to college. I decided I was going to improve my life that way. I was going to quench my thirst that way. And so I was an A student. I went to college. I was graduated with honors, got a free ride to graduate school. This girl from a broken home from the inner city. I thought that was going to quench my thirst. I graduated, had a great job, everything I could have wanted, a car, a beautiful apartment, and guess what? It didn't quench my thirst. And I said, God, if you know what I'm missing, can you show me? And he did. I was missing the righteousness of Christ. There's only one way to be right, and that's by receiving Christ as Savior, because he takes all our sin away. He removes it from us and makes us new. And when I heard that, that was water to my soul, that was dried and parched, and he filled me, and I was changed. I became a new person, and I didn't need to drink anymore. I didn't need to do anything to quench my thirst. I didn't need to have money to quench my thirst. I didn't need to have friends. I didn't need to have a boyfriend. I didn't need anything, because now I had the Spirit of the living God living inside of me, and I was a new creation. Praise God. Praise the Lord. So I showed her this. Praise God. I told her this, and before my eyes, she gave her heart to Christ. And I had that. And another girl who received Christ when she was 3 years old, grew up in a Pentecostal church, she started praising the Lord and recommitted her life to Christ too. Praise God. And then I help them disciple each other. I teach them how to pray and pray together this week, and because, you know, there's nobody there but them, each other. And so when they leave, they're new people. And I had one woman get saved and changed, and she, I think I told you that story before, she started teaching her children to pray, one woman at the prison, when they visited her on a Saturday night. So that's what we do in U.S. Missions, as U.S. missionaries to Elkton, Maryland. It's a blessing and an honor, but this ministry can only happen because of monthly sustained support. So those of you who are partners with me, you guys, we've got people who make a faith promise, and this is how you become a partner with me. You just fill this out and promise by faith that you'll support us as long as God enables you. And the people that support us enable us to do this, to go out and win souls for Christ, because we couldn't do it without you. So I appreciate you guys more than you know. And I also appreciate this guy right here, my husband Tom, because he's my partner in the ministry. Tom, could you stand up, please? Thank you, honey. I want to thank him because he was retired, and I was asked him to do the ministry with me, and here he is, a U.S. missionary with me now. So he is with me all these places except the detention center. He's not there yet, but we are forming a team of another woman's going to be with me at least. We're getting that going, so please pray for us. If you want to become a partner with us, that would be great. We have these forms in the back. You just put our name and number and then hand that to Tom and I. But also, if partner with us by praying, take a prayer card and pray for us, please, because this kind of ministry takes prayer. There's an enemy to our soul that wants to take us down. When we sang that song today, Jesus makes the darkness tremble. And I forget sometimes. I do. Sometimes I think the things that happen are in the natural. The Lord has corrected me this week that this is a spiritual battle against my life. And the moment when I decided to become an evangelist, that's when all hell broke loose in my life. But Jesus is stronger. Jesus will defeat our enemy. And so no matter what you experience in your life, Jesus will defeat the enemy for you. We just need to pray and believe and walk in the Holy Spirit of God. So that's just my intro today. That's okay. We've got all day, right, to hear the word of the Lord. Amen? No, just kidding. All right. Let's pray. Lord Jesus, we thank you that you make the darkness tremble, that where we go, you go before us. I thank you, Lord, for your word. I pray, God, that you would sharpen us with it today, that you would make us fit for battle today. I pray, Lord, that whoever is here or watching online, you would quench their thirst today with the living water. Lord Jesus, we love you. We praise you in this house. I just pray a blessing over all of us here. And again, Lord, ask your Holy Spirit to come and touch us by your word. Amen. Amen. So let's open up our Bibles, if you've got one, or your phone, whatever you've got, to John chapter 4, verses 3 to 42. I'm going to read this to you. John chapter 4, verses 3 to 42. It's a little faint there. I should have used a different color. That's okay. Praise the Lord. I'll read it to you again one more time. John chapter 4, 3 to 42. I'll try not to move my head too much. This is written through the Holy Spirit by the Apostle John. This is the apostle that Jesus loved the most. And this is John's account. Now he, speaking of Jesus, had to go through Samaria. So he came to a town in Samaria called Sychar, near the plot of ground Jacob had given to his son Joseph. Jacob's well was there, and Jesus, tired as he was from the journey, sat down by the well. It was about noon. When a Samaritan woman came to draw water, Jesus said to her, "Will you give me a drink?" His disciples had gone into the town to buy food. The Samaritan woman came to draw water. I'm sorry. The Samaritan woman said to him, "You are a Jew, and I am a Samaritan woman. How can you ask me for a drink?" For Jews did not associate with Samaritans. Jesus answered her, "If you knew the gift of God and who it is that asked you for a drink, you would have asked him, and he would have given you living water." "Sir," the woman said, "you have nothing to draw with, and the well is deep. Where can you get this living water? Are you greater than our father Jacob, who gave us the well and drank from it himself, as did also his sons and his livestock?" Jesus answered, "Everyone who drinks this water will be thirsty again, but whoever drinks the water I give them will never thirst. Indeed, the water I give them will become in them a spring of water welling up to eternal life." The woman said to him, "Sir, give me this water so that I won't get thirsty and have to keep coming here to draw water." He told her, "Go, call your husband and come back." "I have no husband," she replied. Jesus said to her, "You're right when you say you have no husband. The fact is, you have had five husbands, and the man you now have is not your husband. What you have just said is quite true." "Sir," the woman said, "I can see that you are a prophet. Our ancestors worshipped on this mountain, but you Jews claim that the place where we must worship is in Jerusalem." "Woman," Jesus replied, "believe me, a time is coming when you will worship the Father neither on this mountain nor in Jerusalem. You Samaritans worship what you do not know. We worship what we do know, for salvation is from the Jews. Yet a time is coming and has now come when the true worshipers will worship the Father in the spirit and in truth, for they are the kind of worshipers the Father seeks. God is spirit, and his worshipers must worship in the spirit and in truth." The woman said, "I know that the Messiah, called Christ, is coming. When he comes, he'll explain everything to us." Then Jesus declared, "I, the one speaking to you, I am he." Just then, his disciples returned and were surprised to find him talking with a woman. No one asked, "What do you want?" or "Why are you talking with her?" Then, leaving her water jar, the woman went back to the town and said to the people, "Come see a man who told me everything I ever did. Could this be the Messiah?" They came out of the town and made their way toward him. Meanwhile, his disciples urged him, "Rabbi, eat something." But he said to them, "I have food to eat that you know nothing about." Then his disciples said to each other, "Could someone have bought him food?" "My food," said Jesus, "is to do the will of him who sent me and to finish his work. Don't you have a saying, 'It's still 4 months until harvest'? I tell you, open your eyes and look at the fields. They are ripe for harvest. Even now, the one who reaps draws a wage and harvests a crop for eternal life, so that the sower and the reaper may be glad together. Thus the saying, one sows and another reaps, is true. I sent you to reap what you have not worked for. Others have done the hard work, and you have reaped the benefits of their labor. Many of the Samaritans from that town believed in him because of the woman's testimony. He told me everything I ever did. So when the Samaritans came to him, they urged him to stay with them, and he stayed 2 days. And because of his words, many more became believers. They said to the woman, we no longer believe just because of what you said. Now we have heard for ourselves, and we know that this man really is the Savior of the world. Praise God. Hallelujah. This man really is the Savior of the world. So Jesus was traveling on his way from Judea, traveling north to Galilee, to clear up a misunderstanding. So if we take a look at this slide, slide number 2, he stops in a town in Samaria called Sychar about noon, near the plot of ground Jacob had given to his son Joseph at Jacob's well. Jesus was tired, as he was from the journey, assuming he must have traveled since sunrise at least 6 hours, right? They didn't have a car, they traveled, they walked. It was now noon, and it was getting hotter by the hour. You know, this is significant that he had to go through Samaria. It's like going to the other side of the tracks because they didn't get along. For me, growing up in the city, I knew what this was like firsthand because I lived in a neighborhood mostly Italian. There were other neighborhoods you just didn't go into because you were afraid to go, honestly. If you went into there, you would expect a little pushback. And you might get jumped, you know, some, or if they, other people from other neighborhoods came into our neighborhood, now not me, but I watched all this, you know, really. I was a bystander of the horror. It was awful at times, you know. And people were afraid to come into the white neighborhood. Well, I should say the white Italian neighborhood. It was hard for me, though, because I had blonde hair in an Italian neighborhood, so that was really hard. Because there was an Irish neighborhood, right, not too far. And the Italians didn't even go into the Irish neighborhood. So I get it. Like, this racial tension is real. And we experience this today. And I'm sure that people in the city still experience this, but it's very real for me in the 70s. There was a lot of racial tension in Philadelphia. If you were around then, you know that. So it's just the same way. Jesus had to go through Samaria. He had to go. He wanted to go through Samaria. Most of the people would go around, all the way around to not go through there. So Jesus went into places where the culture says don't go. Right? And he expects us to do the same. This is the same region where we hear the story of the Good Samaritan in Luke 10, 25 to 37. Right? The Good Samaritan helped the Jewish guy who was hurt, when even his own people, the priest and the Levite, wouldn't help him. But the Samaritan did. You see, Jesus cared about this issue. He pushed this issue. And I believe that he needs to push this issue with some of us. Let's take a look now at the dialogue we see in chapter 4. Jesus initiated this dialogue with the Samaritan woman. Will you give me a drink? He asked her a question. Why are you talking to me? She says. How can you ask me for a drink? You are a Jew, and I am a Samaritan woman. So there again, she's noting the racial tension, and not just the racial tension, the fact that she's a woman. And Jesus wouldn't talk to is not supposed to talk to a woman. Men were not supposed to talk to women that were not their own wife. They weren't supposed to talk to women in public. And so there again, Jesus is showing us that there is no Greek or Jew, male or female, slave or free in the kingdom of God. This was a new idea to them. But I love Jesus more than ever because of this, if I could. But he already made me new, so I already love him because he changed my life and made me a new creation. But now we can learn that Jesus expects us not to see people differently because of their sex or their ethnicity or their culture or their political views, right? And if we do, then we're not acting like Christ, and then we've entered into sin. Jesus answers that question with, he doesn't answer her question. He answers the question with, if you knew the gift of God and who it is that asked you for a drink, you would have asked him and he would have given you living water. The Samaritan woman thinks Jesus is speaking of actual physical water. And then she brings up a cultural, political point of contention. So she's actually buying into this political discourse as well. She ignores, but Jesus ignores it and brings back the important issue again, right? She brings up Jacob, and he ignores it. Did you hear that? She brings up politics, he ignores it. Why does he ignore it? Because it's not important to God's kingdom. And the scripture tells us this. 2 Timothy 2:23 to 25 says, don't have anything to do with foolish and stupid arguments, because you know they produce quarrels. And the Lord's servant must not be quarrelsome, but must be kind to everyone, able to teach, not resentful. Opponents must be gently instructed, and there he means spiritual opponents, in the hope that God will grant them repentance, leading them to a knowledge of the truth. You see, Jesus does not allow himself to get up in a senseless controversy, and neither should we. He answers her and tells her the most important things anyone will ever hear. So when we look at that discourse, he tells her in verse 13 the most important thing that we should ever tell anyone. Everyone who drinks this water will be thirsty again. But whoever drinks the water I give them will never thirst. Indeed, the water I give them will become in them a spring of water welling up to eternal life. But she's still not getting it. She's still not comprehending his meaning. Sir, give me some of this water so I won't get thirsty and have to keep coming here to draw water. So she's not getting it. Did you ever talk to someone and tell them this important idea and they're still not getting it? Sometimes they could joke, or sometimes they could deflect. We get this, I remember getting this with students a lot. They would joke if they didn't understand something. My younger students, not my older students, right? I've got some of my high schoolers in the room, so, you know, the middle schoolers especially, like, you know, young kids. Sometimes we can act like young kids too. Sometimes adults can do that when they don't understand. How many of us are stubborn or hard-headed or just ignorant or blind about what God is trying to reveal to us? I was like that too before I came to know the Lord. My brother used to tell me about Jesus. I wasn't getting it. I would say things like, he was a great teacher. Oh, I love Jesus. He was a great teacher. Just like Martin Luther King, I said to him one day. I think he was just like, she's not getting it. We're hard-headed. My father used to say, testa dura, like a hard head, right? That's an Italian expression. You see, many times as people, we are hard-headed and we allow our own ideas and conceptions blind us to the truth, that Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life. But notice that Jesus doesn't give up on her. Does Jesus turn around and walk away? No, he doesn't give up. Let's take a look at the next slide. Now, Jesus reveals to her in unmistakable way that he is the omniscient God, the all-knowing God. He has to break down her misunderstanding by revealing what he knows about every detail of her life, just as God knows every detail of your life, that there's no detail in our life that God does not know about. He knows it all. and loves you anyway. And me. Go call your husband and come back. I have no husband. She lies. You are right, because really, she doesn't really have a husband, but she had five husbands. But, you know, she's already broken this covenant. So, you know, if you look at the way the Jewish law was written, you know, she had broken the covenant. But the thing was this, she had to lie, because if you were an adulterous woman, you could be stoned. So she lies. She didn't want to admit that now the man she was with was not her husband. And you know, of course, Jesus taught us that there's a better way. He didn't condemn the woman caught in adultery. He doesn't condemn her. So this is not meant to be condemning. God requires us to have that relationship as husband and wife as a sacred relationship. That's meant to be sacred because of how special it is and how sacred it is. Many times, though, Jesus must address something in our past to reveal the living water that he has provided for us. And that's what he does. He allows us or helps us become aware of our sin, because we all sin and fall short of the glory of God. He allows us and wants us to become aware of our sin so that we can receive the living water and be changed. So he has to reveal our sin to us, or otherwise we just keep living in it and we keep carrying a burden of sin on our back that weighs us down and stops us from being all that we're meant to be. When we don't live according to God's word in the Spirit, then we do not become the people we're meant to become with all the gifts and talents God has given to you. When you become born again, you become a new person, and you become the person God created you to be. He restores you back to the way he created all of us back at the beginning of creation. When he breathed his breath into us at salvation, we become that person again. We start on that journey to become that person again until we see him face to face and we're glorified, and he finishes the process as we're in his presence. Can somebody say praise the Lord? One day we will not battle our sinful nature whatsoever. But now we do have victory over it with the help of the Holy Spirit. The Samaritan woman, in my opinion, no doubt struggled with guilt and shame because of the mistakes of her past. It was bad relationships, bad decisions, the shame of having one failed relationship after another. No one wants that. She didn't want that. And the fact that she went to the well to retrieve water at the hottest time of the day, why not go the other time of the day when all the other women were there? Did you ever feel like, I don't want to see anybody? I don't want to go around all those people? You know, Satan throws a spirit of shame on us. You know, we have sin, but when we receive Christ, the burden's gone. For those who haven't, they struggle with sin and shame and guilt. I believe that with all my heart, because I experienced that. But when we receive Christ, he's removed every sin as far as the east is from the west from us. But somehow the enemy still tries to condemn us. He brings it up and brings it up and brings it up so we don't serve him, so we don't share who we are, so we don't share our testimony. So we really need to receive the living water of the Holy Spirit to be cleansed and set free. Jesus came to deliver us from sin and shame. Not just so that we can go to heaven, so that we can start eternity now and have a spirit-filled life. I struggled with that terribly when I was a new Christian. At first, for the first probably, you know, several months, and probably a while, I don't remember, it was a long time ago now. I was on cloud nine. I was discipled. I became a Christian. I had this wonderful body of believers that supported me and cheered me on as I quit my job in the public school. I became a Christian teacher. That's when I started the ministry way back when. And I remember I only made $16,000 a year. It was awful. So I went to this woman who was like, okay, I made it. I made a lot of money. Now I'm all right, to giving it all up. But anyway, I was loving the Lord and loving to serve him. And then the enemy would come and throw shame on me from my past. And there were some things in my past I had to heal from. Right? And that's a process, but God will bring you through it. But in the meantime, listen, there is no shame anymore. You can throw that off like a sack of wheat. You don't need it. I was so bad. The Lord gave me a vision one time. I remember we used to have retreats. Remember that, ladies? Our women's retreats. Here, we're going to do that again. We're talking go away and just be with the Lord for the weekend. Anybody remember those times? Well, one time, men, we had prayer times. We had worship times. I remember when I was at one of the prayer times, and the Lord actually gave me a vision of me before the throne. It was beautiful. He gave me a picture in my mind. I'm not crazy. He gives us pictures in our mind. And he was taking off weights off the back, my back, packages, because they were weighing me down. And he showed me that I don't need to hold on to that shame anymore. Praise the Lord. You see, he wanted to free her. He went to her purposely because he wanted to free her. And he wanted to show us that's his business. Praise God. Amen. Amen. So you're set free today. Male, female, you are set free from your past. And he says, go sin no more. He gives you the Holy Spirit to enable you to do that and sin no more. We don't live that life anymore because that's a deadly life. That's a deadly. Amen. Now we walk in the Spirit and he will enable you to do it. 1 Peter 2:24 says, he himself bore our sins in his body on the cross so that we might die to sin and live for righteousness. By his wounds, you were healed. As far as the east is from the west, so far has he removed our transgression from us. Psalm 103, verse 12. The word says, therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. Old things have passed away. Behold, all things have become new. Praise the Lord. The gift of God is his grace and love. He is the Savior of the world, all of us. And the living water is his Holy Spirit, the Spirit of Jesus living inside of us. But she still doesn't get it and thinks he's a prophet because he just told her everything she ever did. Then Jesus addresses the woman's prejudices. He wants to address our prejudices too. It's not so important where we should worship, but who we should worship and how we should worship. Because she brought up that business about Jacob and Jerusalem and where they should worship. It's not important where, it's important who, and it's important how. That we worship in the Spirit. We don't worship according to a rote piece of paper. We don't worship the way people tell us. We worship God in the Spirit with all of our being. Singing praises, talking to him, raising our hands. We worship in the Spirit and the truth that Jesus is the Savior of the world. There's nothing I could do to gain my salvation. And it's all him. He changed us. He made a way. He gave you a new life. He set you free from darkness. He wrote your name in the book of life. And no man can blot it out. And I told that to Melinda. I told her that. That the angels are rejoicing right now because you came to know Jesus. So if anyone does not know Christ right here, right now, say, I receive you, Jesus. Come into my life. Make me new. Take my sin away. I believe you died on the cross for me. I believe you were put in a grave and you rose from the dead so that I will live too and have a new life that starts now and is eternal. And he's with you every step of the way. Jesus, I believe you. And that is for whether you are black, white, brown, rich, poor, male, female, no matter who you are, where you come from, Jesus loves us all, and he is the Savior of the world. And that is the gift of God. Hallelujah. Finally, it seems like she gives up arguing and debating with God. As we should give up debating with God. Stop debating God. Just put your faith in him. Amen. Somebody needs to hear that. Your scientific brain that wants to analyze everything is not going to figure it out. Amen. Stop debating God. Stop believing God has brought calamity upon you or suffering. He hasn't. Satan has, but Jesus has set you free. Stop debating God. just believe. He said those who believe him must, those who please God must believe him. It pleases him when we believe him. Our faith is what pleases God. We can't do anything to make God love us more. We can't do anything to make God love us less. It's all faith in him, and that's pleasing to him. Finally, and then she says, well, I guess the Messiah will explain everything to us. Like, oh, well, I'm not going to argue with you anymore, mister. And finally, Jesus says, I, the one who am speaking to you, I am he. And I feel like it was like a thunderbolt in her soul. And that's what God does for us. At the right time in the right place, he sends that thunderbolt to you because he will hunt you down. He wants you to receive him, and he wants to change your life. There is no place you can run from God. You cannot run from God. He will hunt you down because he loves you that much. Praise God. So just give up and start following him. If God gives you a calling, believe me, don't run from it, because he's never going to stop calling you. He will knock on your door every day. Stop. Stop knocking. Stop knocking. He will knock on your door every day until you answer the call. Praise the Lord. So stop arguing with God and receive him and listen to his voice. He says his sheep hear his voice, and you hear his voice. So just follow him. And sometimes we don't know the whole picture. Like when the Lord called me into the ministry as a woman, I did not think I could do that. I was like, no, I don't know what you mean, Lord. You know, I grew up in an old-fashioned home. We were Catholic, you know, and then when I got saved, I went to a good old-fashioned Pentecostal church, which I loved. But all the preachers were men, and the deacons were all men. And I was like, what do you mean, feed my sheep? What do you mean by that? And it took me a long time of study, really. I had to study and get mentors to help me. You know, Pastor Allen was one of those. Pastor Edward Minaldino from Calvary Temple of Philadelphia has now gone home to be with the Lord, who's well known all over the world. Then Pastor Allen mentored me and helped me see that women have a place in the ministry and the pulpit. And I thank God for that. But because God did not, it was like knocking on my door, and I couldn't, you cannot stop God's call. Praise the Lord. So, what is this living water that we all have? The Holy Spirit of God. It fills every empty place in your mind, soul, and spirit. It is hydrating. What was once dried up makes a spring. Jesus says, let anyone who is thirsty come to me and drink. Whoever believes in me, as the scripture has said, rivers of living water will flow from within them. Jeremiah 17:7-8. I love this, the prophet Jeremiah. But blessed is the one who trusts in the Lord, whose confidence is in him. They will be like a tree planted by the water that sends out its roots by the stream. The Spirit makes you fresh and vibrant. It fills every space within you. And it is a place where others can be refreshed as well. Praise the Lord. So I'm very thirsty. I'm going to have some water. So this living water, I mean, there is no better example that God could have used than water. Scientifically, we know it nourishes every living thing. We can't live without it, just like we can't live without the Spirit of God. I've seen that. People who reject the Spirit of God dry up and die away. We can't live without God's Spirit. It quenches our thirst. I have to have a drink, so. It quenches the thirst. Every thirst you have, it will quench it. Regardless of what it is, what you need, Jesus will quench your thirst. But that requires us to go to him and ask him to quench your thirst. And if Jesus doesn't quench it, it's poison. Don't drink it. If what you're asking for is not Jesus, it will poison you. But only the the living water will quench your thirst. There's nothing else that's going to quench your thirst. So that living water quenches our thirst that we have, every thirst that we have, every thirst that I had for success or validity or just being right. It was only Jesus that could quench my thirst. I had tried mostly everything else. Seriously, anybody else try everything else? Anybody try anything else? And it was only Jesus that could quench my thirst. The other thing about water is that it fills us completely, right? There's no shape that water cannot fill. Tall, thin, it fills every nook and cranny. Right? It fills us completely. We're satisfied. And that is the secret to life, to being content in Christ, to being content with what we have, and not always wanting more. Because Jesus fills us completely if we allow him. If we keep searching and searching and getting more cups, we're never going to be filled. And that's what we do. We want more and more and more and more and more, and we're never satisfied because it's the cup of Christ that fills completely. That's it. You know, the other thing about water, living water, is that it changes us completely. So it quenches our thirst. It hydrates us if we're dry. It brings new life, but it also changes us completely. We become a new creation, new. Our stony heart turns into a heart of flesh. I became a new person. You know, all my bad habits went away. Just one little example. This is one example. I tried to quit smoking for years. You know, it was cool back then to smoke. It's not. It's deadly. But I hated it. I tried to quit. But I couldn't do it. Years. And then as soon as I came to know Jesus, like that, he delivers us. He makes us new. He changes our minds and hearts. We're not the same anymore. But guess what? I can't explain that. I can't explain it. How he goes into every cell in our bodies and makes us new. How he changes our soul, that I can't explain. There's one other thing I can't do. I can't make you drink the water. Only you can choose Christ. Only you can choose to have your thirst quenched by the living God, by the Holy Spirit. You see, I can't do that either for you. I can show you how he quenches my thirst. I can show you how he's filled me completely, but I can't show you how he's changed, except by my life. That's it. And I can't make you drink it. Only you have to decide to drink and be filled, and that'll change your life. So I want to encourage you today to receive the living water that Christ makes, that Christ gives you. It washes the old man away, the new man is born. It is a supernatural water. When you drink this water, you are born again and made completely and utterly new. When this new person, the living water, makes you, when you become this new person, you become eternal also. The moment you drink the living water, eternity starts for you because you were dead before and now you've a new person that is eternal. God puts eternity in our hearts and he wants it filled, and it can only be filled by our spirit, his spirit. So the moment you receive Christ, you become eternal. You start the process of eternal life. Isaiah 1:18 says, "Come, now let us settle the matter, says the Lord. Though your sins are like scarlet, they will be white as snow. They are red as crimson, they will be like wool." Colossians 2:13-15, "When you were dead in your sins, in the uncircumcision of your flesh, God made you alive with Christ. He forgave all our sins, having canceled the charge of our legal indebtedness, which stood against us and condemned us. He has taken it away, nailing it to the cross. And having disarmed the powers and authorities, he made a public spectacle of them, triumphing over them by the cross. I can't explain that. That's the work of the Lord. This living water quenches every thirst you will ever have. It is eternally satisfying, and you will never be thirsty again if you receive Christ as your Savior. Never. It completely satisfies. John 4:14 writes, "But whoever drinks the water I give them will never thirst. Indeed, the water I give them will become in them a spring of water, welling up to eternal life." And as you know, people try to quench their thirst with all kinds of things: alcohol, success, money, fame, relationships. These things will never quench the thirst of a person's soul. So, praise God. Now, meanwhile, the disciples return. She gets saved. The disciples return, and they're surprised to see Jesus speaking to a woman. Again, we see that, and John the Apostle is showing us that. Purposefully showing us the prejudice of the day so we will not repeat it. The disciples had to learn that the kingdom of God is not about eating or drinking or male or female or Jew or Greek, but about righteousness, peace, and hope in the Holy Spirit. They were concerned about physical needs instead of spiritual needs. Spiritual needs should always be our first priority as Christ followers. Jesus was about the Father's business. Check out verse 32. I love this. "I have food to eat that you know nothing about." Could someone have brought him food? They had no idea. "My food is to do the will of him who sent me and to finish his work." Look at verse 35. "Open your eyes, look at the fields. They are ripe for harvest." And I say that to all of us today. Open your eyes and look at the fields. They are ripe for harvest. Who is going to go into that harvest field and bring in a harvest? In verse 39, many of the Samaritans in the town believed in him because of the woman's testimony. She went and brought in the harvest. Why? She told them the following: "He told me everything I ever did." What a simple testimony. And then the town returned and came to believe in Christ. And that's all we have to do, is tell people what he's done for us, your family, your friends. You think they've heard it before, tell them again. People are hard-headed. We can't give up. As we're filled with the living water every day, because sometimes we run out of water, right? And we have to drink again and be filled again with the Spirit. We have to be filled every day, and that only comes by being with my brothers and sisters, fellowship, praising God, reading his word. Share your testimony. We've got to get people saved. We've got to get our family saved. Don't give up. Pray for them. Tell your children about him. Tell your friends. Tell your neighbors. All right, so I'm going to close with 3 points. Jesus gives us a new life. Let's recap. What do we learn from this wonderful story? I think I finished that. They all come back. They all get saved. The town, a whole town gets saved because of her testimony. A woman gives her testimony. She was the first evangelist. The first evangelist. She goes and gets a whole town saved. Praise God. Now that's the truth of God's word. And so we can use God's word to learn about what we should be doing. Just look at the word. Get with other folks and other believers. Read the word. Find a mentor. Girls, women, if you're called to the ministry, find a mentor that will help you. It's hard. Guys, young men, same. Men, older men, we all need a mentor. You guys need a mentor as well, especially if you feel the call of God, which we're all called if we're believers. That's extra. That wasn't in my notes today. But we all need a mentor to help us. We all need each other to go fulfill our calling. And I can bet that if we're not walking with the Lord, if we're not filled with the Holy Spirit, it's because we don't have other believers alongside of us helping us do that, because we're the body of Christ and we need each other to fulfill the calling that God has for us, the Great Commission to go make disciples of all nations. Whatever it is God's called you to do, you need the body of Christ to help you do it. I do too. We need each other to fulfill the calling God has for us. And I'm just so thankful that I have, again, partners in the ministry. You guys help me do this. Whether you serve alongside of us when we go to the school, we're going to need more tutors. Come September, we're going to need more. We're losing a wonderful tutor to college. Right? Sorry, I won't call her out. But we're going to need more because there's a lot of kids in need. We need servants of God. We need people all the time for ministries. And then when I go and share these ministries with other churches, you guys are going to have to take up the mantle and do it here. Right? So we need one another to spur one another to ministry. Thank you for what you do for the body of Christ. I look out here and I see so many servants of the Lord. Thank you for what you're doing. Together, we are making the kingdom grow. And we will continue to serve and give and share. And thank you, thank you, thank you for loving the kingdom, loving your church, loving your community. That's not in my notes either. Thank you so much, because we are making the kingdom grow. Let's look at our last 3 points and close it out for the day, because I know the children's church is ending. I understand if you have to pick up your children. I know that's going to be ending in a few minutes. We get a new life in Christ. Jesus said, I, the one you are speaking to, I am he. We've been saved from sin and given a new life. Oh, living water. Living water is filling. It makes you a new person. And living water quenches every thirst that you will ever have. Praise God. Hallelujah. A new life. Let's take a look. Well, new love. It went out of order. That's okay. Sometimes when you switch over the slides, when you bring them to the, you know, here to new, they switch over. New love. This living water reaches across racial, ethnic, and political lines. Listen, Jesus has given us a new love for one another and for people who are different than us. And that's how we're to walk. There are no lines of separation to him. This life-saving message is meant for everyone. We receive unmerited and gracious love from God. We should have unmerited and gracious love for others. That's the truth. Race, cultural, political, economic differences do not change God's mandate to extend grace to others and share the love, truth, and good news of Jesus, all right? If they're different, that doesn't change our mandate. I think it makes it more of a mandate to share the truth of the gospel, to share the love of God. So if you're avoiding people because they're different than you, that's not God's intention. Perhaps God's given you people who are so different from you because they need to get saved, and he's put them in your life. That difficult person that you have to deal with every day, not your spouse. This life-saving message is for everyone. Praise God. Jesus showed this by talking to a woman, a Samaritan woman, no less. We see the prejudice in the culture by the disciples' surprise. Jesus gave new validity to women as well as those who are foreign to us, whoever that may be. As Christ followers, we must love for love's sake and overlook any differences that we have with others. We have been forgiven now and have a new capacity to forgive. He cares for you deeply and wants to give you living water to fill you with the Spirit, regardless of what we have done. We have to have a new love for ourselves as well, a new love for others, and even a new love for ourselves. Sometimes we have to forgive ourselves and start to love ourselves in a new way. Stop the enemy from telling you lies about yourself. Sometimes we have to actively tell the truth to our soul and spirit. When the enemy tells you a lie about yourself, you have to respond with the truth. If the enemy says, you made this mistake, you say, I'm washed in the blood of Christ. If the enemy says you're nothing, say, I could do all things through Christ. I am a child of God. You have to reverse those negative thoughts and have a new love and forgive ourselves, because self-love should reflect God's love. It's powerful. We should have a new life in Christ. We talked about this already. We've been saved from sin and given a new life. We've been restored to God no matter what you've done. There's no longer any separation. God sees no sin or fault in you, only love. And why is that? Because of Jesus. Justice was met when Jesus died on the cross for you. And now there's no longer any condemnation. I'll say that again. Justice was met when Christ died on the cross for you. And there's no longer any need for a sacrifice for sin. So we have a new life. We have a new love, my friends. And we have a new purpose now, a new mission. The harvest is ready. We have to be willing to give up our material desires to share the message of Christ. We have to have that attitude. My food is to do the will of him who sent me. The Samaritan woman was on a mission to tell others the good news. And Jesus wants us to understand that our food is to do the will of him who sent me. So now as Brian's going to play, I want you to consider these three questions, whether here in your seat or if you want to come up to the altar and talk to the Lord and do business with the Lord. I want you to ask yourself these three questions. The first question is this. Do you need a new life? Are you without Christ? Only Christ can make you new, and he can. He can take your hard heart and cleanse it completely and make you be born again and take every shackle of sin that weighs you down. Maybe you need a new love today. Maybe you're harboring unforgiveness. Would you stand with me? Thank you for listening today. Thank you for receiving this. Let's ask ourselves these questions. Do I need a new life? Do I need a new love for someone? Have I harbored unforgiveness in my heart? Do you need to forgive someone? How about this question? Are you holding on to prejudice because of past offenses and hurts? Do you have racial hatred for someone, regardless of their race, white, black, brown, everything in between? God tells us to examine our hearts. Have we hurt someone today? Have we encouraged division within the body? You see, Jesus shows us by our example how to forgive. And by the Spirit of God, we can forgive ourselves and we can forgive others. We can say, Lord, forgive me, and he does. But we've got to repent. To receive the gift of God requires us to come to him and say, I'm sorry, Lord. Will you forgive me? And he does. But in order to get that gift requires repentance. You see, Jesus had to reveal to the Samaritan woman her sin so he can pour the living water into her and make her totally clean. Jesus will set you free from your hatred. Jesus will set you free from unforgiveness and pain. Whatever it is, Jesus will set you free today. And my last question, do you need a new mission in life? Are you living by the mission that God has given to you? And I know that some of you are, and let's celebrate that. You can be validated today and say, thank you, God. You've given me a mission and I'm completing it. But if you're not, why don't you do business with the Lord and say, Lord, I want to do what you've called me to do. Sometimes it takes a little while. Sometimes it takes a lot of time at the altar. But I want to encourage you today. Let's reflect on these questions today. And whatever it is God's touching your heart with before we end, we're going to just play this and then we're going to close and we're going to go about our day. But let's first be touched by the Spirit of the living God. That you've given to us, Lord. I thank you for what you've done in our hearts today and for the hearts of those who are here or online, Lord. Help us, Lord, to live for you, to have a new life, to do your will and your work, and to have a new love for others. In the name of Jesus, Lord, the enemy will not steal this word today. And those who gave their life to you today, I pray, God, you would fill them now with your Spirit. For those who you've revealed, Lord, a heart that needs forgiveness of others, I pray, God, you would give them the grace that they need to do whatever it is you've called them to do. And Lord, for those called to the ministry, Lord, give them the strength that they need to follow you in whatever it is you're calling them. Lord, I thank you for this day. And Lord, now we praise you and thank you. May the Lord bless thee and keep thee. May the Lord make his face to shine upon thee and be gracious unto thee. The Lord lift up his countenance upon thee and give thee peace. In Jesus' name we pray. And all God's people said, amen. Amen. Thank you, my friends. Have a wonderful day. Thank you. Praise the Lord.
Right? Now, back in the day when some of my family was starting to come.